Our Heavenly Father, we praise you because of the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the incredible grace and mercy you lavished upon us, Father, so that we might be reconciled to you. Lord, we recognize that apart from this cross of Christ, apart from our Lord and Savior giving his life as a ransom for us, we would have no hope. But because he did, and because he rose from the grave, Father, we have every reason to be joyful, to be confident in you, to praise you. Father, as we walk through your word this morning, I pray that your Spirit would take your word and apply that to our hearts. And Lord, that we would be open and receptive and responsive to you. And I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. It's good to see you this morning. And just a quick word, couple of words. Yes, please do invite your friends, family, coworkers, so on and so forth, your classmates. I pray you will, for the sake of the gospel. And you may say, well, where are they going to sit? We're going to bring out more chairs next week, okay? And we may be packed like sardines, but I would like to be packed like sardines because we have a lot of people from the community here. I don't know about you. And so let's pray towards that, okay? And our church members, in case you're wondering, well, where we park? Several will be parking over by the bus barn to free up spaces here, so we don't need to worry about not enough seats, not enough parking, okay? So let's prayerfully go out and ask our friends if they might join us in worship. Now, today is not a Palm Sunday sermon. And you might say, oh, it's Palm Sunday. We're staying in our sermon series, and I think that the reason that I felt led to continue to stay in this series where we're looking at the claims of Jesus is because these claims ultimately are what lead the leaders of his day to want to kill him. And we've been looking at some incredible claims. And you might wonder, when you think about Palm Sunday, how in the world could all of these people be shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, and then like 5 days later, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. Here's what happens. The people of Jesus' day imposed who they wanted Jesus to be on Jesus, and he was not who they wanted. They wanted a political and a military deliverer from Rome. And you might say, well, looking back at those people, they just didn't get it. C.S. Lewis warned us against the dangers of what he called chronological snobbery, meaning that we look back over the ages and say, well, those people just didn't get it. Well, I'll tell you how we do this with Jesus. We do things of Jesus because we impose who we want Jesus to be in our own lives. We want a Jesus who's going to baptize our sins, our desires, our everything that we want, because we want that Jesus. And when we run through the Gospels and we see the Jesus who is, he makes us uncomfortable. So I want a Jesus that's here to make me healthy, to make me wealthy, a Jesus who's going to make my life comfortable. A Jesus who's going to make my life stress-free. A Jesus who's going to say, you know what? Here, I've entrusted you with everything. All of this is a gift, but you do whatever you want to with it. A Jesus who will say, you know what? Even though I died for my church and I love my church, don't worry about it. You just go when you feel like it. It's not a big deal. We want a Jesus who looks also very much like us. So we can't look back at the people of Jesus' day and say, well, those people, we need to look at ourselves, okay? Jesus makes incredible claims that demand a response. And we've looked. Now, if you've not been here and you've not been walking with us through these claims, actually, some of these will build on what we've already looked at, and we will review those. But these claims demand that we respond, demand that you respond and I respond. And I hate to say it, but right now, I hate to say it, every single person in this room is already responding. Not to me, but you're responding to Jesus. Some of you are saying no. Some of you are saying, you know what, I'll think about it. Some of you are saying, yeah, I want to follow you, Jesus, but only if it's not hard, only if it's not difficult. Others are still saying, Lord, I want to follow you wherever you lead, no matter the cost. I don't know where you are, but Jesus is worthy of the latter response, the last response. What we're looking at today, I want to give you a little bit of background, takes place in the temple and takes place during a feast. It was the Feast of Tabernacles or the Feast of Booths. And the feast, this particular feast was the longest festival of the Jewish year. And it was a celebration of something really specific. I want you to hang on to this. This is very important, okay? The celebration of this feast was a celebration of God's gracious provision for the Israelites after the Exodus when they were in the desert. Hang on to that. That's really, really important because when we see, when we hear what Jesus says, you're going to think, oh my soul. It's powerful. During that feast, they would remember the rock that provided water in the wilderness in that Exodus. They would recall that God provided water for the thirsty Israelites in the desert. They would also recall the pillar of fire that provided light and guidance. They would remember that, how God gave direction, light, and guidance for them in the desert. With that in mind, in this feast period, Jesus starts to make claims about himself that tie in with this feast, that to his contemporaries are somewhat, well, I won't say somewhat, very much scandalous and offensive. I want us today, and we're going to, now when I say we start in John chapter 7, you can turn there. And then when I say we're going to look at a lot of John chapter 8, I don't want you to think that we're going to be here for forever. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to story several sections of this, but we're going to try to focus on some key moments in this story. We're going to look at some key passages and key verses so that we can fully understand what it is that Jesus is saying to us and about himself. Okay, so anyway, as we go into this, I want us to try to go back 2,000 years. I want us to feel the tension. I want us to feel what these people would have been going through because Jesus is going to make us, if we're paying attention, really uncomfortable. I heard an advertisement for a church, I won't mention the name of it, it's here in town, and it was on the radio, and it was like, hey, come and hear a guiltless message full of grace and nothing but positive stuff, so on and so forth. I'm never here to guilt, but I thought, wow, how in the world is there ever a guiltless message? Because the Bible says I'm guilty before a holy God. So how does that work? And how do I receive grace if I don't acknowledge that I'm guilty? How does that work? Jesus is going to say some stuff today, and I pray we pay attention, not for the sake of pain, but for the sake of truth. Can we do that? Some of you are scared to death. Like, where are we going with this? We'll be gentle. I'm also, as I've told you several times, I'm always preaching to myself first, okay? I'm not preaching at you. John chapter 7, verses 37 through 39 are going to provide a little bit of the context for us as we get started. On the last day of the feast, again, this feast is celebrating what? Remembering what? Oh my, we've already forgotten. God's provision during the Exodus, right? Water from the, and the pillar of that gave light and guidance. Okay, good, good, doing good. On the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and cried out, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." Now this he said about the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive, for as yet the Spirit had not been given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Did you catch the first thing he says about himself during this feast? That relates to the feast. I am the rock that gives water. That's what he's saying. Whoever believes in me, out of his heart will flow what? Rivers of living water. Jesus promises for those who believe in him that he will satisfy our deepest thirsts and longings. This is taking place during a feast when they're remembering how God provided for thirsty Israel as they're wandering through the desert, water through a rock, and then Jesus says, "You're thirsty, come to me." I want to ask you about your thirsts. All of us have them. But what happens so often in our culture and often in church, we go to other places, other people, except for Jesus to have that thirst satisfied. Jesus is the only one who can satisfy your deepest thirst. When you follow him, when you trust him, he gives you his Holy Spirit. Doesn't mean your life is suddenly comfortable and everything is perfect. What it does mean, the things you've been looking for, you're only going to find them in Christ. Another musical reference, last week I used some, and people did not get most of them because they were 90s stuff. So remember Bono saying this, "I still haven't found what I'm." That's where some of us are today. You're looking anywhere and everywhere with Jesus, and Jesus says, "You come to me. You come to me." That's a pretty big claim, isn't it? That's a huge claim. If any of us said that, you'd say, "Well, that's kind of odd that someone..." But Jesus says, "You come to me. I will satisfy your thirst. Whoever believes in me out of his heart..." You see the contrast between the hard rock and this heart? Will flow living water, gushing out of the heart. And Jesus doesn't stop there. Now we go to John chapter 8. He connects himself more to the feast. Look at John 8 verse 12. "Again, Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.'" Do you see what he's doing? He keeps pointing. He's saying, "You know what? Those things that happened back then, they're wonderful and great. They're pointing towards me, and I'm greater than that." And we're going to see this as we go along, that those who were listening to Jesus fully understood. Now he's saying, "I am the true light that you are remembering, celebrating. You follow me. Follow me, and you'll have the light of life. You'll walk in the light. If you don't, you'll remain in the darkness." That's what he's saying. That pillar of fire gave light and guidance to the children of God as they wandered in the desert. And Jesus is saying, "I give life," light rather, "that brings life." So these two statements start to get people worked up. And Jesus doesn't stop there. He continues to press forward because he wants people to know the truth. He makes these claims, and the reality is that he's making these, and just in these two claims, he's making claims that really only God can make. And believe me, the Pharisees, the religious leaders, they understood it, because you look at verse 13. The Pharisees said to him, "You're bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true." So they're already worked up. They don't like where he's going. "You can't say this because you're making some pretty crazy claims." And those are claims that only God can make. So what they're saying is, "You're a liar. Your testimony is not legally acceptable. It doesn't have the proper amount of witnesses. The law required 2 or 3 witnesses. And you're just saying things about yourself. No one else testifies this about you." So Jesus ratchets things up a little bit more. Look in verse 18. "I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me." He's saying, "You want the two witnesses? There you go." And who does he identify himself with? The Father. Who did what? Sent him. Now again, if any of us said this in this room, we'd get a lot of strange looks, wouldn't we? This is all taking place during this great feast, and here he is in the temple doing this. The Father sent me. He bears witness about me. Things continue to get more tense, so the Pharisees want to ask, who is your Father? And Jesus' reply is, "You don't know me or my Father." John 8, look in verses 23 to the first part of 25, we read these words. Jesus, he said to them, and try to soak this in. Here he is looking at people who are very upset with him. You can't make these kind of claims. And Jesus said, you are from below. I am from above. You are of this world. I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. So they said, who are you? Now, they don't have a real interest in knowing who he is. They are very angry. Did you see what Jesus said? You're from below. You're from Hades. I'm from above. I'm from heaven. You are products of this world. I am not. I am not of this world. Can you see how things might be a little bizarre for those that are watching, and maybe they're stressed and they're angry? This is all taking place, and Jesus is saying this about himself. And then he goes so far as to say, and if you don't believe in me, you're going to die in your sins. Do you see how powerful these statements are? And you might say, well, Jesus is being kind of cantankerous. Maybe he's just being argumentative. No, Jesus knows he is humanity's only hope. That's why he's come. He is our only hope. He's God the Son who came to ransom us from our sins, to pay the penalty for our sins. And so he makes all of these statements to these people and to you and to me. And all of us must respond to him. All of us. And as we feel the tension, they're asking, who are you? Now, they really don't want to know. They don't want to hear, oh, you're God the Son. They're asking us because they want to trap him. They're not truly seeking truth. They want him to straight out say something that they can accuse him of blasphemy, because they know where all this is going. They can see it. Look in verses 31 through 33. They've asked him, well, who are you? So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. They answered him, we are offspring of Abraham. We have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? Now, the specific Jewish people in this text had a superficial belief in Jesus at this point, and Jesus says something that angers them. He says that his words are truth that sets people free. If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Abide in my words. Embrace them. Act on them. Cling to them. Do that, and you are my disciples. And in doing so, you will know the truth, and in that, you will be set free. The only way you and I will ever experience freedom from the lies of this world system, freedom to live as we were created and intended to live in a relationship with our Heavenly Father, is by coming to Christ. And apart from him, we are in spiritual bondage. We are not free, and we don't like to hear that. Now, if you think of not being free and being in bondage, does that bring you back to the Exodus? Absolutely. The religious leaders are getting increasingly angry, and so they're saying, we are free. We're not in bondage. We are children of Abraham. You might say, what's the deal with that? Again, the Feast of Tabernacles, celebrating God's provision, freeing the Jewish people from their bondage in Egypt, and providing for them water for thirst, light for guidance, those things all related to their exodus from slavery. And now Jesus says, I will set you what? Free. Which means, apart from me, you got to flip it. If you don't come to Jesus, are you free? No. None of us are. Apart from Christ, we are in bondage. We are slaves. The scripture says that we are slaves to sin. We are in bondage to sin. We don't like to hear this either, but this is what the Word of God says about us. And he says, Jesus is our only hope. Now, you might protest, I'm not in bondage. I'm not a slave. I'm a free person. I do what I want. Well, scripture says for all of us spiritually, apart from Christ, we're not free. So if you are paying attention, you see what Jesus is saying and doing. He's making all of this very personal, and he's pointing people to himself. While they're having this celebration, this great feast, He's redirecting them back to himself. Now, those people that are present, they understand and they grow increasingly upset, and the confrontation gets even more intense. For the sake of time, I will paraphrase and then we'll move forward a little bit. First, Jesus acknowledges, yes, you're all physical descendants of Abraham. That's what the Jews counted on for their salvation. Just a quick word, you might say, well, again, the chronological snobbery comes into play. Well, of course, it's not your ethnicity that saves you. You know what I've heard a lot of times when I talk to people over the years about where they stand with the Lord Jesus Christ? I hear things like this. Oh, I've gone to church my whole life. Okay. Well, have you placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ? Oh, I go to church. My dad was a deacon. My dad was a pastor, or my so-and-so. No, have you placed your faith and trust in Christ? Have you actually acted? Have you given your life to him? No, I believe. I believe in Jesus. And James said, you believe in God, good. Even the demons believe that and tremble. Have you placed your faith and trust in Jesus? Well, I really try to be a good person, and that's where some of us, I guarantee you, I know the statistics, some of you are right there right now. That's your story. And you are trusting in the wrong thing. Jesus is your only hope. You cannot be good enough. I cannot be good enough for him. So Jesus says, oh yeah, you're descendants of Abraham. That's where they place their faith in their ethnicity, their spiritual lineage. And Jesus counters by saying, if you were really Abraham's spiritual descendants, you would do what he did. You'd be obedient to God's direction, even if it is difficult and you don't know where he's leading. In fact, you want to kill me, and Abraham would have never done this. You are really doing the deeds, the works of your true father. And now things get really intense. The Jewish people present say, we have only one father, and that's God. And Jesus said, if God really was your father, you would love me, because I came from God and he sent me. But because you don't understand this, because you were not able to listen, meaning your hearts are hard, your ears are closed to the truth. And Jesus says this, look in verses 44 through 45, and you want to say, oh my soul. Yep, he goes here. You are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning. Jesus knows they want to murder him and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Are you feeling the tension? You are what? Children of the devil. That's pretty strong words, right? Here's where we get confronted with something, and some of us need to come to terms with this right now. We like a certain Jesus that we have created in our own image. And in America, he's somewhat like this. You know, and sometimes in older churches, you may see pictures along the wall, right, of Jesus. And who is he? He's a willowy white guy with blonde hair from the 60s, and he's holding a sheep. Okay, Jesus is a carpenter, was son of a carpenter, okay? He was Jewish. And the Jesus in our culture is very, very safe. Oh, he's safe. He doesn't want anything from me. He just loves me. That's why I can sin and do whatever I want, and he just loves me. It's okay. God is love, and yes, he is. But we forget the other part. This Jesus, the Jesus we find in Scripture, he's safe. I mean, not dangerous. He's not safe. He's dangerous, but he's good. Quote, paraphrasing Lewis again, C.S. Lewis. He's not safe, but he is good. And we have to respond to him. We don't respond to the Jesus that we have made in our own mind, the little construct that we have. We need to respond to the Jesus who is. And Jesus right here, he makes us uncomfortable with what he's saying. So I don't like that part about Jesus. Jesus is very gracious, very loving. But he's also, he's demanding. And you know why? He is worthy of being demanding, because he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Jesus is saying, I'm speaking the truth and you don't believe me because your real father is a devil and that's who you're obedient to. He's always been a murderer, always been the father of lies. That's who you are. That's why you don't understand. Then Jesus asks them a question that also makes a powerful statement. Look in verse 46. Which one of you convicts me of sin? He knows that's what they're trying to do. Which one of you convicts me of sin? If I tell the truth, why do you not believe me? I want you to think about that statement Jesus just made. He says, basically, name, while we're at it, name one thing that I have done that is sinful. Would any of us dare to make? I mean, if I said that, you'd all go, oh, wait, I'm first in line. I'll tell you what you've done wrong. Yet Jesus stands in front of these people and basically, name one thing that I have done. Have I sinned? That's an incredible question, and none of us would dare ask it, but Jesus is saying he is sinless, and he says, I challenge you, find that in me. You won't. They don't answer the question because we can't find any sin in him, but they do believe the things that he is saying in their mind are blasphemous, and that he's guilty of that. So they ratchet up the accusations. We'll continue to story through this. One, they insult him by calling him a Samaritan, which really was, in all likelihood, implying that he was born out of wedlock. Things are getting very, very tense. Then they say he has a demon. Well, that's actually committing blasphemy, attributing the work of God to Satan. So now everything is very uncomfortable. So what does Jesus do? He leans into it, not because he likes conflict, but because he is all about the truth and he wants people to be set free. Look in verse 51. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death. Okay. Big statement, right? He continues into this, and again, last week we saw Jesus, when we talked about Lazarus, claim that he had authority over what? Death. Here he goes again. Do you see? They keep pushing, and what does Jesus do? He stands firm, and he speaks the truth, and he's looking at all these people who are celebrating this feast, and he's saying, all of this is ultimately pointing to me. That's what he's saying. This is simply what Jesus says now. It's too much. They've had enough, so they push back because they don't like all that this implies. Look in verses 52 to 53. The Jews said to him, now we know you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets. Yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Here's the question. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died? And the prophets died. Remember, Jesus said he had authority over death. So they say, who do you make yourself out to be? And some of you are asking that right now of this Jesus. Wait a minute, well, who is he making himself out to be? Those are some pretty big statements. They're saying in this passage here, in these few verses, you're not from God. You say you have this power over death. Well, Abraham died. All the prophets died. Are you greater than Abraham? Greater than the prophets? See, here's the litmus test, because again, they take pride in being children of Abraham ethnically. So look at Jesus and say, are you greater than him? Oh boy, we've trapped him now. We've trapped him out. I mean, here we are. We've said Abraham, the father of the faith. You, are you greater than him? If you're making statements like that, that's what you're really saying. Are you greater than Abraham and the prophets? Look in verses 56 to 57. He says this, your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. So the Jews said to him, you're not even 50 years old. And if you and you've seen Abraham? Now, there's a lot of big stuff going on in these couple of verses. First of all, Jesus says, you know what? Abraham saw my day and he embraced in faith the many promises God gave him. He saw my day. Promises that demanded also the coming of the Christ to be fulfilled. So Abraham rejoiced when it come to me, but you're trying to kill me. You are in no way like Abraham. You might say, well, I don't see that. Well, the Jews in that time, they understood what he's saying because look what they said. You're not even 50. How could Abraham see you? In other words, he's been dead thousands of years. How in the world has he seen you? And then Jesus says the most incredible thing of all. Verse 58, Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. Now, some of you may not know what that reference is. This is power. Can you, when you put all this together right now, can you see? Can you feel it? Can you feel what was going on? Can you see how Jesus is demanding a response? Can you see how he's not backing down? What is Jesus doing in this, in verse 58? He is claiming to be divine. You might say, well, I don't see that. He says, before Abraham was, I am, pointing back to Exodus 3:14, reminiscent of God's name. Jesus knew this. The Jews understood what he is saying, and they have had enough because Jesus is claiming to be God. Wow. It's all been building up to before Abraham was, I am. Guess what he's saying? I'm divine, eternal. I was before Abraham, greater than Abraham. That's heavy stuff. And guess what? Jesus is greater than everything else you're hanging on to for your hope and your salvation and for your everyday life. He is, because he is the Son of God. You might say, if you look at this, oh, I don't see that Jesus is claiming to be the eternal, preexistent God, the Son in the flesh. He's not saying that. Well, you know what? Guess who understood it? The people that were present understood it, because in verse 59 it says, so they picked up stones to throw at him. They want to stone him for blasphemy. They know full well what he has said. This whole thing is like, that's enough. You are committing blasphemy because you're claiming to be God. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. His time is getting near, but not yet. Now, we don't know. Scholars who look at the language here, and they say, well, how did Jesus get through all of that? Most believe that it was he did something. We're not told it specifically, but some kind of a miracle so that he could get through and that he wasn't to be stoned to death because it was not yet his time. And that's not how he was to die. So all these things taking place in this very important feast in the temple, in the house of God, Jesus stands there and says, I am. Whew. God the Son. Before Abraham, who has existed from eternity past, saying that all of you religious people, you're children of the devil. You don't know the Father. It's a remarkable scene. And I will just say this, and I think it's important for us to come to terms with. It is very, very, very easy to be very, very, very religious and to not know Jesus, to not follow him. Okay? Let's not confuse religiosity with being a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, because being a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ means that we deny ourselves and we take up our cross and we follow him, that we exchange our life for his life. Whoever would save his life, Jesus said, must first lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Those are his terms. Many of us have bought into the lie that we can live life on our own terms, our own way, write our own rules. Jesus is either King of Kings and Lord of Lords and worthy of all obedience and following him, or he's not. He's not someone we tack on to bless our lives, to baptize those things that we want to do. He is Lord. We talked about this last week. Incredible claims demand an incredible response. And you and I must respond to Jesus. He is either who he said he is or he's not. He cannot merely be a wise teacher or a good prophet or a good spiritual leader if he is not who he claimed to be. Do you see why? The reason why, some of you are wondering why, he could not, if he is lying and these are not true, he's not a good teacher, is he? He's not to be trusted. if he is lying, then you and I have to reject him as a deceiver, but he is not lying because an empty tomb bears witness. The explosion of the early church bears witness because countless people said, no, we've seen him. He's alive. His disciples, we've touched him. We've talked with him. How many of you know? Now, I was a very young kid here, so don't say, these references. How many of you know who Chuck Colson was? A few of you. How many of you ever heard of Watergate? Okay. Chuck Colson went to prison for Watergate. But in there, he became a Christian. Gave his life to Christ and spent the remainder of his life running and serving well. Incredible man. And he said this about this idea, because some people say, oh, well, the disciples just, they made all this stuff up so that they could, What happened to all the disciples? Martyred, except for John, who was scalded with boiling oil and exiled on Patmos. And here's what Colson, and I'm paraphrasing this, he said, you know what? He knew men, and this was a much smaller thing. They weren't facing death. They were facing prison. He said, guys started to crack like this. He said, there is no plausible way that anyone is going to die for what they knew to be a lie. If you were trying to make something up about Jesus, you're a disciple. Yeah, he rose from the grave. I touched him. Oh, we're gonna lop your head off. Just kidding. Didn't happen. You'd do it and I'd do it. But they didn't, because they knew. They saw him. They touched him. We know because of the explosion of the early church, and we know because of the reality of transformed lives throughout history. And many of us here would say, yes, Jesus changed me. He saved me. He is either the Son of God or he's not. He cannot be both. And again, the claims he makes, he demands a response. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to have our invitation. And I want us to all not distract our neighbors if we could, just for the next few moments. I want us to all continue worshiping through the invitation by responding to the Lord as he leads. Now, there's a few ways you might feel led to respond today. Some of you may be here and you have never given your life to Jesus Christ. Perhaps you've been religious and what you may think is I'm a good moral person or some such thing. I encourage you today, give your life to Jesus. Give your life to Jesus. When we stand and sing, I'm going to ask you to be very courageous. You can leave where you're seated, and if you'll come forward, I'll be up here, and we'll talk, and we'll set up a time to meet, and we'll rejoice with you, okay? You a brand new creation. That's what Jesus does to us. Some of us here, perhaps we have strayed very far. And maybe it happened all at once, or maybe it was just incremental compromise along the way. And we have forgotten that he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords and worthy of our obedience. And some of us need to rededicate our lives to him today. Some of you may be looking for a church home. And I'm simply going to say this. We are moving forward as a church, and we're going to be moving forward together as a church being on mission in our community. We're moving towards two services and two Bible studies. And if you feel the Lord leading you to plant yourself here as one who invests, I'm not trying to be rude, but we're not looking for consumers. We want people who are going to serve. If you believe, yes, this is where I want to be. I want to serve here and be on mission here. You come forward and say, I want to plant myself here and serve. Others of us may just want to come forward and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. However we need to respond, let's do so by saying yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. Our Heavenly Father, I want to praise you and thank you. Lord, you are worthy. Lord Jesus, you made so many incredible statements about yourself. You claimed to be the only way to have a relationship with the Father. You claimed that you and you alone could forgive sins. You claimed that you had authority over life and death. And today we saw multiple claims that you made. You are our only hope. And we ask and I pray, Lord Jesus, that during this time of invitation, that we would respond to you as you are worthy. And I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.